What's going on, guys? Welcome to a brand new episode of Tariq Radio. I am your host, Tariq Nasheed. Glad to have everybody tuning in, ladies and gentlemen. Today's show is brought to you by RecorderWatch.com. Are you dreading your company's annual holiday party? Are you looking for a discreet solution that automates the documentation of tacky, trashy, and terroristic comments that violate company policy? Well, get the 8-gigabyte voice recorder that's very discreet at RecorderWatch.com. Yo, we're going to have a real deep conversation on tonight's broadcast. But Thanksgiving, we're going to chop up game about the real deal about Thanksgiving, ladies and gentlemen. So it's a deep show. I need y'all to grab your pens and your paper because you're going to want to take notes on tonight's broadcast, ladies and gentlemen. And what we're going to do, we're going to take a commercial break. Let everybody know that we're live right now. And we will be right back right here on Tariq Radio. Don't move a muscle.
Yo, you still ain't getting women? Really? Come on, son. You need to go to badboymembership.com and step up your game. What's up, y'all? It's your boy, Mr. Locario, the bad boy of the dating game. And I'm telling you that if you really want to attract beautiful women, you need to go to badboymembership.com. This is where you get 45 through 90 minute step-by-step dating advice tutorials every month. Just sign up, follow the advice, and you'll get the woman you want. Go to badboymembership.com. That's badboymembership.com.
Check out the website darkblack.me. That's a website where they train individuals on gun safety and marksmanship. As foundational black Americans, we're getting closer to getting those tangibles, but the white supremacists are becoming more aggressive, so it's important that black people protect themselves in these trying times. Go to the website darkblack.me and purchase the gun training and marksmanship instruction videos right now at darkblack.me.
Feed Your Soul Organic. Go to www.feedyoursoulorganic.com to order medicinal plants in the form of teas, powders, and oils. Enjoy fresh, revitalizing health products from the motherland. Available to you quickly because we ship from the USA. Operated by a foundational black American, you can trust that you are receiving the very best of Africa. Purchase African coffee, noni, soursop, baobab powder, and so much more. Strengthen your immune system one day at a time. Feed Your Soul Organic. That's www.feedyoursoulorganic.com.
Check out a brand new website / message board called BlackCommunitySpeak.com. Black Community Speak is the place where black men and women can get together to talk about issues that affect the entire community. Now, Black Community Speak is different from sites like Lipstick Alley and others because both black men and women are equally welcome there to chop up game. So go there right now. Let everybody know what's on your mind at blackcommunityspeak.com. That's blackcommunityspeak.com.
If you are looking for an educational program to keep your children engaged and learning during the quarantine, order Gifted and Lit. Gifted and Lit is an award-winning program that teaches kids math, science, language arts, financial literacy, and more. Download their content instantly at giftedandlit.com. Remember, that's giftedandlit.com.
Yo, guys, don't let COVID-19 keep you from achieving your health and your fitness goals because your health is cut from the same cloth as your wealth, and you need to be the best version of yourself, and you can do that with Salomon's Gym products and services. Salomon offers custom online training made just for you, and he has ankle, thigh, and power bands that will help you tone your body and burn fat anywhere you choose to train. So go to SalomonsFitnessWorld.com, enter the coupon code Tariq, and save 10% on your order. That's SalomonsFitnessWorld.com. Yo, check out a brand new book out right now called Letters from Everywhere. Now, this is a book by a sister named Wani Spots. Wani Spots is the first black woman to travel every country and continent on the planet. Check out her book and dive deep into the black presence around the globe and explore the black experience from her point of view. She has art on every page, and the reader is inspired by the international destinations, foods, and practical travel guides. So check out Letters from Everywhere. It's available right now on Amazon, and if you have Amazon Kindle Unlimited, you get it for free. So Letters from Everywhere right now on Amazon. Are you looking for 100% natural beard product that cleans the skin under your beard and it stimulates growth? Then check out Beard Tree Oil and Herbs, LLC. They promote healthy beards over everything. They offer a full line of products including beard and face wash, balm oil, mist, and detox. So treat yourself to the Beard Tree 3 package, which includes the wash, balm, oil for just $25. For best results, check out the Beard Tree 5 that includes all five products for just $50. So check this out all at BeardTreeOilAndHerbs.com. That's BeardTreeOilAndHerbs.com, or follow them on Facebook and Instagram at Beard Tree Oils and Herbs. Check out a brand new book by author Jay Babilaw entitled Black Serviceman to Black Veteran. This book, author Jay Babilaw delivers an immersive and intelligent read about his personal experiences in and after the military, and he talks about how these experiences shaped his outlook on life forever. This personal novel reads much like a self-help guide, but it's a very deep book and you need to check it out. It's called Black Serviceman to Black Veteran, available right now on Amazon.com.
If you enjoy luxurious home fragrances, check out Scented Company. Our 100% natural candles are made of pure soy wax and essential oils to create aromatherapy-inspired fragrances that can help with insomnia, stress, energy, and hormone imbalances. Take our scent quiz today. Find us at our website, scented.company. That's scented, S-C-E-N-T-E-D.company. We are live and lit.
Check out AloDiki.com. AloDiki is an all-natural product line that works by improving the actual quality of the skin. They have a face and body oil that will help repair eczema and damaged skin, sunburns, rashes, and much more. AloDiki also has an oral rinse that will help get rid of cavities. So check them out right now at AloDiki.com. That's A-L-O-E-D-E-E-K-I.com. Also follow them on Instagram at AloDiki.
Hey, it's So Flawless, what's new? If you are looking for the hottest fashions such as dresses, jumpsuits, and casual pants, then stop on by now to fitsoflawless.com. We also have accessories that are available to complement any outfit. So come find your fit at our online store, fitsoflawless.com.
Tune in to the Jamil Marley Morning Show every Saturday, 9:30 a.m. with your hosts, Jamil Marley, Kiana Quarles, and DJ Godzillas. Search Jamil Marley on YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, Twitch, and Periscope.
The year is 2079. The futuristic nation of New Albion has been created to maintain a new racial apartheid system. There is a planned genocide that is going to target the nation's black population. A small group of black revolutionaries band together to launch guerrilla warfare attacks against their oppressors. Do they fail, or do they succeed? Find out the answer by reading the book, Avoid the Machines, the new novel by author Scotty Vasco. Avoid the Machines, now available on Amazon and BarnesandNoble.com.
You are now tuning into the legendary Tariq Nasheed.
I gave a little blood on that bridge in Selma.
On Tariq Radio.
I said, whoever threw that paper, your mom's a hoe.
Oh, we're back, ladies and gentlemen. We are back. Glad to have everybody tuning in to Tariq Radio. Glad to have y'all tuning in on this lovely Thanksgiving Eve, ladies and gentlemen. By the way, everybody, if you have not purchased Hidden Colors 1 through 5, you can get that at HiddenColorsFilm.com, ladies and gentlemen. HiddenColorsFilm.com, Hidden Colors 1 through 5, including the film 1804, The Hidden History of Haiti. We're still working on the buck-breaking movie right now, coming out early 2021. I want to see what this COVID thing is going to be like in early 2021. to know if we're going to do a theatrical release. I really want to do a theatrical release for Buck Breaking. So hopefully this COVID thing will be in order. So we'll see what's going on with that. But it's holiday season, so everybody's getting into the holiday mood. By the way, all my audio people, my people who know how to work FL Studios, I need y'all to holler at me again. There's some stuff I'm trying to do, and I need some of my computer audio production literate people to help me out. I had some people hit me up like last year when I needed some audio help. So I need some of my people who know how to work audio programs like FL Studio to hit me up. I got a couple of basic questions, and some of you guys are real thorough with that stuff. You can email me at info@tariqelite.com. But I digress. But a lot of stuff we're going to talk about on tonight's broadcast. Everybody, while you're coming in the room, hit that thumbs up button. Hit that like button. Ladies and gentlemen, hit the thumbs up button, hit the like button so we can chop it up. Now, we're going to talk about the real deal about Thanksgiving. We're going to do that a little bit later. Before I get into that, we're going to talk about Obama being on the Breakfast Club this morning. Did y'all see that? Former President Barack Obama was on the Breakfast Club and he was doing a lot of niggersplaining. My dude Charlemagne asked him some real questions. He asked him some very real questions, especially about people's complaints that Obama has not done anything for black people. Obama tried to do his splaining and doing the Democrat double dutch by trying to double talk. And people are starting to finally see in large numbers what big of a con job Obama was. Now listen to Obama give his jive ass excuses about what was done for black folks. You know, you're going to be hearing these talking points for the next 4 years. They're going to double down on all of that disproportionately affected talk. So now they're going to wheel him around now to do all the splaining for them and lying. They're reduced to lying at this point. But let me play the audio of Obama, and I'm going to break the stuff down in between the audio of him. It's a couple of minutes. It's not that long, but here is some of it.
I think people want to know, like, what did you do specifically for black people? Not the rising tide lifts all boats types of rhetoric, because we all know black people's boat got a hole in it. So the systemic things that were done to black people to put us in these positions, we need specific systemic things to get us out. So
what I'm saying, Charlemagne, is black poverty dropped faster than everybody else. Black incomes went up more than a lot of other folks.
No, it didn't. No, it didn't. No, it didn't, guys. That's just not true. You know, under Obama, black people lost a lot of wealth because of, you know, those janky ass housing loans, those what they called ghetto housing loans. That really wiped out a lot of black wealth. Black wealth didn't really go up like that under Obama. Let's stop that.
So, you know, the issue is sometimes we just didn't go around advertising that, because once again, the goal here is to build coalitions where everybody is getting something so that they all feel like they've got a stake in it.
But Obama, wait, so when it comes to black people, y'all didn't go around advertising all of these great things that you mythologically did for black people, which you didn't do. Oh, it was something in secret. You had to do it in secret. We just didn't see all the tangibles that you created. Oh, it's I'm the magic Negro with the magic invisible tangibles that you niggas just didn't know about. Because we have to build coalitions. We got to make everybody feel included. Well, how come we're not included in those Indian tangibles? How come we're not included in the tangibles for the Jewish community? How come we're not included in the tangibles for the Hispanic community? We weren't included in that. So what are you talking about? This is niggersplaining.
The goal here is to build coalitions where everybody is getting something so that they all feel like they've got a stake in it. But a lot of my policies were targeted towards people most in need. Those folks are disproportionately African American.
Oh, stop. Oh, family, when they start running the disproportionate, no, that lift all doesn't help us because it keeps us on the bottom. I broke this down a couple of days ago. We are on the bottom of everybody else. Why? Because everybody else gets specific tangibles. They get specific resources that excludes us. And they don't get sabotaged when they get these resources. Whenever we get something, we get sabotaged. So we have to have exclusive, tangible resources that are protected, because anything we get in these lift-all programs, it gets sabotaged anyway. So everybody gets resources to double down on oppressing us. It's a totem pole that we're on the bottom of. Don't let them run the totem pole game, guys.
Those folks are disproportionately African American. Now, there are some things that, for example, us having a civil rights division in the Justice Department that actually took seriously civil rights.
Nigga, please. All the black people that got killed under Obama, what civil rights? And he didn't do anything about it. The civil rights laws he's talking about are being used for the white LGBT community right now. They're benefiting from the civil rights law. This nigga's running a con game. Obama didn't do one damn thing to any race soldier for all of the damn deaths that happened under his watch. He didn't do anything. No civil rights. That didn't work for us. It's working for the white LGBT, though. You see, this dude is slick with it.
And imposed consent decrees on places like Ferguson. And
dude, the cop who killed Mike Brown is still walking around now. Nothing happened in Ferguson, but a bunch of flunkies got put in place down there and all the real G's got killed off and nobody knows who killed them. All of these mysterious murders that were never solved for the real activists down there and all of these Democratic plants that got put down out there. And by the way, there's another activist in Louisiana who was protesting for Breonna Taylor. He was helping out with a lot of protests out there and he just got killed. This was like a couple of, I think yesterday, he just got killed. A dude out here who was a protester, who was kind of organizing a lot of stuff on the grassroots out there in Louisiana. So a lot of protesters who are real deal are being targeted by law enforcement. These law enforcement agencies are openly in bed with these white supremacist groups right now. Obama, they were doing that under Obama. Remember, the FBI put out a memo under Obama stating that there were white supremacist groups joining law enforcement. He didn't do anything. What the hell is he talking about? So, yeah, he's not going to come around us trying to run that slick game to promote his damn book.
Actually took seriously civil rights and imposed consent decrees on places like Ferguson and, you know, changed sentencing guidelines so that we didn't max out on sentencing for all nonviolent drug offenses.
Okay, and this is another thing that Obama keeps doing. He looks at us the same way white supremacists look at us. Obama keeps making black people synonymous with criminals. Have y'all noticed that? This is a thing with Obama. Yeah, I help black folks with the criminal justice reform and the crime and the drug sentence. So we have to commit a crime in order to benefit from one of his programs. So this whole anti-black notion that black people are synonymous with criminality, that's bullshit.
I changed the incentive so that prosecutors were judged not by how long of a sentence you got, but did you get a proportional sentence? Was it a fair sentence? You know, those kinds of changes that we made, that's why I say there's a reason why the federal prison population dropped.
Man.
By the way, at the same time, the crime also dropped.
Nigga, right, so we're not all criminals, dude. Dude, we're not all criminals, man. This nigga sound like his white grandparents who raised him. We're not criminals, dude. We are not criminals. Black people are not synonymous with criminality. And also these drug sentencing laws, that's benefiting these white people now. Because as you know, these drug sentencing laws that are being changed is helping these white people with all this meth and all of this heroin. In places like Oregon, they're decriminalizing meth and heroin and all those hard drugs that white people use. Those laws are for white people. They're changing those laws that's going to benefit white people, and then they try to flip it as if this is some kind of plus exclusively for black folks. No, it's not. Stop this game.
That you can have a smart strategy in terms of reducing.
Oh, God. Okay, so that's y'all boy, man. Some of y'all out there still caping for the damn Democrats. Y'all still running around here going to the damn fish fry. That's your boy right there running the whole Democratic con game on us. This dude is a snake. And by the way, Obama, he followed me for years on Twitter. He doesn't follow me anymore. Within the last couple of months, it must have been in the last few weeks or so, he stopped following me on Twitter. So, yeah. All right, do you, brother. Because I've been going in on him heavy and his fraudulent behavior. But family, y'all sitting up here caping for the damn Democrats because y'all was scared of Trump. And man, we're jumping out of the water right into the frying pan. We're going to get a lot of 4 years. The next 4 years is going to be a doozy for foundational black Americans. And again, the only people that's really caping for Obama right now, the only black people doing all this caping for Obama and Kamala and all these people are black LGBT and black folks with foreign flags all in their profile, trying to run that game on us while trying to convince us that the Democrats are doing great things and they're not. They already got their benefits, just them being over here. They've already came up. So of course they're gonna cape for them and try to run a game on us. We get nothing out of them. And Kamala is still trying to be sister girl. She put up a picture. I should have put the picture up here, but she put up a picture talking about how she's going to be cooking for Thanksgiving and she's going to make some stuffing. If y'all go to my Instagram and see this cornbread dressing, she put up a picture of some cornbread. This is the driest looking nonsense I've ever seen in my life. Anybody telling me that this woman is remotely black with that dry ass dressing that she put up, I'm like, lady, you look like you're about to make some curry dressing or something. I've never seen dressing like that. It looked horrible. It looked like a bowl of granola. It was horrible looking. And y'all sitting up here trying to tell us this is some kind of sister girl. And everything that she tries to do culturally, FBA, falls flat. Everything. But anyway, I digress. Let's get into what we need to talk about. Speaking of Thanksgiving, guys. So it's Thanksgiving time right now. And I want to talk about the real Aboriginal history of foundational black Americans. We got to get into this. And I need y'all to get y'all some pens and paper because I need y'all to write some stuff down so that you can do some more research on your own. But y'all need to write some of these names down. I'm going to have a lot of receipts here about who foundational black Americans really are. Now we know as foundational black Americans, we are the people who came over in captivity, starting with the Spanish and then with the French and then with the English. We were brought over from Moorish Spain. We were brought over from parts of Africa. But let's talk history. The reality is, it is my conjecture that it was a very small percentage of people who actually came over from Africa over here to the northern part of America. A lot of the people who came over from on the slave ships in Africa were really down there in Brazil and South America when you look at the numbers. But a relatively small number of people from the African diaspora were brought here. A lot of people don't look at it from that perspective. That is because a lot of black people, of people who would later be classified as black, were already on this land. Now, when you talk about that, that's a very controversial subject. Because a lot of people start talking about, well, why you want to deny Mother Africa? Well, we all came from Africa. Saying that we're African this, African that, that's almost redundant because at one point we all came from Africa. But when you start looking at the real evidence, many people who were classified, who would later be classified as black, were already on this land. and there's so much proof, but the dominant society goes out of their way to not have us acknowledge that, because what they did was they ran a big con game on us. The white supremacists came over and they acted like a parasite. They took over our land, told us we were from somewhere else and this is not really our land. And now when you look at a damn Native American, they look like Justin Timberlake. I'm the real Native American, dude. How are you Native American? You're a $5 Indian. This is the con game they ran on us. And now when they tell us that we are foreigners, they try to make us comparative with other foreigners. So a lot of immigrants, they always feel like they have to latch on to whatever we have going on because we're African Americans. You understand? And this is why the word African American, that's been a term that's worked against us. We got to be very clear about this history. Because family, we have to look at this country. This is our land. We were here before all of these other groups. We're not visitors or guests here. We're not comparative to immigrant groups. We've been here for thousands of years and they know this, but they have to keep pushing this. Well, you guys should go back to Africa. I've always found that to be a very strange narrative to throw at us. Number one, they know we can't go back anywhere because we don't know what part of Africa we came from if we did. But that was a very strange narrative. That was a psychological fake out to make us believe that we're not owed anything on this land. This is why we don't really get any tangibles, because we sit up here thinking that we're foreigners and we shit. We just like everybody else. We don't deserve it. And then they give it all these tangibles to white Native Americans or phony $5 Indians who are not Native Americans whatsoever. But family, we have to understand that the real Aboriginal people on this land were jet black people. Now that's either the truth or it's not the truth. That's either the truth or it's not the truth. And I'm not... You don't have to argue with trolls, because a lot of trolls, you know, fuck all that. What all that Aboriginal talk, man? We just came from the motherland now. We all came from the motherland. Y'all niggas just don't, y'all don't love Africa. Africa is our home, brother. Well, why are you living in Cleveland? I'm just trying to save my money to go back to Wakanda and all that. You know, no, we ain't playing that game. We're talking real talk right now. And by the way, we broke this down a decade ago in the Hidden Colors movie. Remember, Hidden Colors 1 and Hidden Colors 2. This was the first time on a massive level that we broke down how black people are the Aboriginal people. We talked about that in Hidden Colors 1, and we went really in depth in Hidden Colors 2. This is 2011. This is 2012. So we were talking about this on a large scale for a long time. So this kind of got the ball rolling now. You understand? But I'm going to give you guys some of the receipts that you need to let you know who you are and who the dominant white society knows who you are. And when we start talking about our history, who we really are, they don't want us to know that we are the Aboriginal people. They go out of their way to pump fake us. This is why whenever these so-called Native American tribes get any tangibles, the first thing they do is start kicking out the black members. That's the first thing they prioritize, because they don't want us looking at documents. They don't want us getting access to those resources. The name of the game is to start kicking us out and erasing our indigenous history. But let's start going to some receipts, guys. Now, remember when the white supremacists first came here, well, in the Western Hemisphere, not just here in North America, even in the Caribbean, some of the people were Aboriginal black. When Columbus came over to Hispaniola, the people told him about these black-skinned people that came from the East and brought these gold-tipped spears. But let's talk about the Northern Hemisphere as far as the North American land. And I put up a meme of this guy right here, Giovanni Verrazano. this was an Italian explorer who came to North America in the early 1900s. He didn't start a colony, but he interacted with the Native American or the Aboriginal people. And let's look at his description. He said, these people are black in color, not unlike the Ethiopians, with thick black hair that's not very long. Now, Ethiopian, that's a term that was used for black Africans at the time. They used to call Southern Africa, Sub-Saharan Africa, they used to call that whole thing Ethiopia. And there's several other instances where this guy is talking about the tall black Native Americans, the tall black Indians. And this is why you have a lot of those Indian tribes with names like Blackfoot. Down in Alabama, where I lived as a child, there's a place called Tuscaloosa. That's named after an Indian. Tuscaloosa means black warrior. It was a 7 foot tall Indian chief called Black Warrior. Down in Alabama, Mississippi, Florida, the Carolinas, Virginia, you had all of these black Aboriginal people. There's a reason why they kept calling them black this, black that, black warrior this, black. Everything was black on these guys. These were the white European explorers telling the world this. And when you look at early images of the Aboriginal people, this is what they look like. These are the people. This is what they look like. If you're looking at the screen, I'm showing you places in North America that European artists would draw. This was early on. They would draw true to life. Now, this picture right here happens to be down in Mexico. Remember, Mexico was a black satellite. The Aboriginal people of Mexico were black too. Let's get that straight. These are some other people, some indigenous people in North America. So we have to understand this is what some of the North American Aboriginal people look like. They look like regular black folks. This is right, another picture right here. American. This is another American looking like regular black people. These are some of the Indian settlements. These were people who would later be classified as black. Okay? So these are artist renderings of what the people look like. This is what the people look like, and they know this. And if you're looking at the picture here, these are some other Aboriginal Americans, black folks. And speaking of Mexico, by the way, let's look at what some of the Mexican scholars said. Vicente Palacio, this is Vicente Guerrero's grandson, the first black president of Mexico. This is his grandson. He said, it's indisputable that in very ancient times, the Negroes occupied Mexico. They brought their own religious cults and ideals, okay? So this is what some of the earlier scholars would say about the people in the Americas. This is another guy right here. Hold on, let me go up. Another Mexican scholar, Carlos Marquez, he said, the Negro type is seen in the most ancient Mexican sculptures. The Negro figures frequently in the most remote traditions of some American pueblos. It is to this race, doubtlessly belongs to the most ancient skeletons distinct from the American red race, which has been found in various places from Bolivia to Mexico. It's likely that we repeat, America was a Negro continent. So that guy is distinguishing the black Aboriginal people from the red Mongoloid Native Americans that we are known to see all over the place now. See, the image of Native Americans or Aboriginal people are the Mongoloid looking red man. Okay? That's the image that we see. They have buried the fact that the vast majority of a lot of the Aboriginal people were black skinned people with woolly hair who look like us. Okay? Now, this is not me talking. I'm showing you some scholars from North America, Central America, all of them saying the same thing. Now, when we get to the year 1740, they start putting the slave codes together, because when they started enslaving people, the narrative that they said was, well, they couldn't enslave Aboriginal people and Native Americans because they knew the land too much and they could run away. But if you're controlling the land, that doesn't mean anything. Yeah, there were a lot of people who ran away, but if you're controlling the land, if you come over and you're like, hey, I'm the white supremacist, I got all the guns and the military and I'm controlling the land, you control the people. If you control the land, you control the people. And the thing is, we can use that same argument in Africa. In Africa, they colonized everybody over there. They knew the land, but their asses still got colonized and had to do what white mommy and white daddy said. So let's be very clear. They colonized Africa, and they know the land, and they have to do what they have to be told by the white supremacists. So the same thing here. The Native Americans, they could have ran here, ran there, but if you got caught and they took you to another plantation, which they did, they took a lot of the indigenous people to plantations and then renamed them. See, when we look at the story about the transatlantic slave trade, we got to look at some of the holes in the story there. Because what they tell you is that people came over from slave ships, and a lot of when they got here, they went to maroon colonies. How did they know where the maroon colonies were? Come on, let's start asking some real questions here. How did these African people, the minute they got off the slave ships, they start running to the hills and they knew exactly where to go where they wouldn't be found? Okay, let's start asking some real questions here. These maroon colonies were all over the place because these were the indigenous people. These were indigenous people, so they knew where to go because they did know the land. They did know how to go in certain swamps. They did know how to go to certain mountains and certain hills. Yeah? So they did know where to go because they were familiar with the landscape. So in the year 1740, you know, they start putting the slave codes together. This is the 1740 South Carolina Slave Code. It says, an act for the better ordering and governing of Negroes and other slaves in this province, whereas in His Majesty's plantations in America, slavery has been introduced and allowed, and the people commonly called Negroes, Indians, Mulattoes, and Mestizos have been deemed absolute slaves. So they're showing you in the law, they're just mixing everybody together. Okay, they're showing you in the law, they just mixed everybody together. They got Indians or whatever, mulattoes, mixed Indians, mixed Negroes, and put everybody in one pot, made one big nigger, and enslaved everybody. Okay? So we got to understand the con game that they run on us now. And when we talk about people like Crispus Attucks was the first brother to take a bullet in the Revolutionary War. He was a black man, and when the British came, the British shot him first. Crispus Attucks, we know he was a black man, but a lot of folks don't know his mother was a full Native American. There are a lot of black people who, especially older, will tell you that their parents or their grandparent is full Native American. Now, for a long time, we would kind of chop that up as them trying to be exotic. I remember when Skip the Truth Gates did his special, he did a DNA test on a couple of celebrities who thought they had Native American ancestry, which they probably did. I don't know what markers they were using to do the DNA test, but he told them that they didn't have it, and he tried to use that to say, well, most black people don't have Native American ancestry. How the hell do you know if all you did was interview and test Oprah and Tina Turner and a couple of celebrity Negroes? You can't speak for all black people because you didn't test all black people, dude. But Skip Gates, we know he's a pawn and a tool of the white supremacist establishment. And they put that out there for a reason, so that black people will stop looking into their indigenous ancestry, so that we feel like we're not owed anything. They've run a major con game on us, guys. They've run a major con game on us. And the picture right here is from the main pictures from a book. This is America, by the way, just so there's no confusion. The image that's on the main page here, this is from a book from the, this was in the late 1800s, early 1900s. I forgot what year this is. But it's an old book showing what the indigenous people look like. And we got more images. This is from the 19th century. Look at the African, and then look at the Native American right up here above the African person. They look the damn same. The Native American person, this is white people. This is how they depicted black people and Native Americans, okay? This is them. See, in the early 1900s, a lot of white people would tell the truth about certain things. They started codifying their lies a little bit later. They had to get their lies straight, but there were a lot of white people messing around and telling the truth. This is another image. The Indian races. Look at what the Indians look like interacting with the white supremacists. This is what they look like. This is what the people, America, look at these black, these are images and paintings that white people did in the 1600s, 1700s, 1800s. This is them. This is in California, where you had jet black Aboriginal Americans in California. This is their artist renderings. This is what they drew, okay? So we gotta be very clear. Now what's interesting, like I said, there were some white people who would tell the truth. And when it was time to get on code, they had to stop that. Now we know about Charles Darwin, and he came up with a lot of these evolutionary theories, the survival of the fittest. And Charles Darwin, he was planting the seeds of eugenics and white supremacy. Charles Darwin's, I think it's his cousin, William Galton, right? Help me out in the chat room. Charles Darwin, his cousin is Galton, William Galton. I think I'm pronouncing his name right. And Galton was the man who really kicked off the eugenics movement. But the seeds were planted with Darwin. That whole survival of the fittest, theory of evolution, and all that stuff. Because, see, they were trying to get on this white supremacist code, meaning that black people were some primitive folks who were in Africa and they were brought over here, but it was these good, worldly white people who navigated the world and brought them over out of their mud huts. See, they were starting to get that lie together. But this was the thing. Darwin wasn't the first person to talk about evolution. The first person to talk about evolution, who Darwin got it from, he got it from this guy named Constantine Raffinesque. Now, Raffinesque was a professor, a scientist. He was from France. Now, Raffinesque, a lot of folks don't know about him, but he planted the seeds of Charles Darwin's game. Okay, let me show Constantine. This is Constantine here. Now, the thing with Constantine Raffinesque, and I want y'all to write that name down. The problem with him, he dropped a lot of game. He told a lot of truth. The problem was he told too much truth. Remember, he was French and he came over here, and the French, you know, they scientifically, they told the truth for the most part, because they weren't on the white supremacist code yet. When they got over here, they really got on the white supremacist code. But Raffinesque, he was talking about the truth about plants and animals and evolution and all that. But he also said, by the way, North America, the indigenous people are a bunch of black folks. And he wrote about this extensively. This is one of his writings on the right, Primitive Black Nations of America. So this guy talked about in great detail about all the black tribes who were here before Columbus. This is a white man saying this in the early 1900s. They don't really want to get all this stuff out. And by the way, this is Constantine Raffinesque's Wikipedia page. And I don't really like it to depend too much on Wikipedia, but they told some truth here. When they talk about him, Raffinesque, they said that he was a polymath, he was self-educated, he traveled as a young man. He's another guy that they play off as eccentric. you know, kind of weird. He was eccentric and he was an erratic genius. See that? Remember the last time I told you about that author out of Chicago? It was a white man who wrote a book in the 70s talking about all these black tribes that were over here in America before white people, and he was talking about the Great Dismal Swamp. I told you about that white author and the white scientific community. They play him off as he's eccentric, he's an erratic, he's a lunatic, and they kind of play the white people off crazy when white people start telling the truth. So they kind of did the same thing with this guy. He's telling the truth, and they're going to play him off as erratic because they said right here he was an autodidact, well, I don't know how to pronounce that word, who excelled in various fields of knowledge, a zoologist, a botanist. He was thorough, but the problem was he said this. Among his theories were that ancestors of Native Americans had migrated by the Bering Sea from Asia to North America, and that the Americas were populated by numerous black indigenous people at the time of European contact. So this is why they play him off as crazy. Okay? When you start telling the truth, autodidact. I can't pronounce that damn word. Autodidact. I've never used that word in a sentence, so I'm cool. But like I said, this guy right here, autodidact. Okay, I got it. There we go. But yeah, this guy right here was very thorough in telling the truth, and they had a problem with that. They had a problem with Constantine and other white men. There were other white people telling the truth at the time. In the 1800s, you had a lot of white people. Gerald Massey, David McRitchie. You had a lot of white writers in the 1800s kind of telling the truth. You know, they were looked at as crazy, but they weren't afraid to tell the truth at that time. You understand? And let's be real. A lot of black people, they knew what the deal was. Hell, Frederick Douglass, guys, this is a quote from Frederick Douglass in 1894. He did a speech when they were talking about colonizing, taking black folks over to Africa and Liberia and all that. And Frederick Douglass was one of the people who was against that. He knew a lot of black people. That's why a lot of black people didn't really go over there like that, because they knew their history was here. They started getting this lie together that we got to go back to Africa. And a lot of black folks were like, well, we're not from there. We're from here. Even Frederick Douglass said, hey, the native land of America, the native land of the American Negro is America. His bones, his muscles, his sinews are all American. His ancestors for 270 years have lived, labored, and died on American soil. So he was against that whole going back to Africa thing. This is our native land. Now, there were some black people. We gave props to Africa. We knew that some of our lineage came from there. We knew that. But we also knew that we were the indigenous people here. We got to really get that through our heads. We've been lied to for a long time. And when we look at places like down there in Alabama, look, but after slavery, you know, there were a lot of free black societies. After slavery, and another thing, a lot of the Native Americans, the Aboriginal people, what they were doing, they were moving them to reservations. They were clearing them up, because when people try to use the argument that, well, Native Americans couldn't have been enslaved because they knew the land. Well, hell, why did they get on reservations then? You understand? Why do they get put on reservations? Yeah, they know the land, but if the white supremacists come over and take over the land, you getting on that reservations, or you on that reservation, or you getting into the plantation. You're going to get on the reservation, or you're going to get on the plantation. You understand? And that happened to a lot of people. Now, after slavery, there were a lot of Native Americans who did not want to go to them plant, they didn't want to go to those reservations, because the reservations were usually in poor places The soil was poor. They didn't have access to water like they needed. They would put these people in some of the poorest places imaginable. So a lot of the native people, the Aboriginal people, did not want to go to the reservation. So what they would do, they would just blend in with black society, especially down there in Mississippi, especially down there in the New Orleans area. These are Mississippi natives right here. This is an old picture from the early 1800s. These are Native Americans, Aboriginal Americans out there in Mississippi, looking just like regular black people. And what's interesting, guys, a lot of the Aboriginal people said, look, instead of getting put on a reservation, hell, I'm gonna just say I'm a Negro. They would choose in many cases to say I'm a Negro so I can live in free black society. So I don't have to get put over here in a reservation somewhere in Oklahoma or somewhere where I'm going to starve to death, because a lot of people were starving to death on those plantations. Those reservations, a lot of those reservations were damn near death camps. And especially down there in Louisiana, a lot of the black Aboriginal people just blended in with black society. Now, they still pay homage to that. If you go down to Mardi Gras today, what do they have? They have the Mardi Gras Indians. You got the black people down there in New Orleans and Louisiana when they do those little funeral processions. What they call them? The second line. When they do those funeral processions and those parades and things like that, they dress up as the Mardi Gras Indians out there in Louisiana. They're paying homage to the black people, or the black Aboriginal people who blended in with black society out there in Louisiana. They're paying homage to that. You understand? We need to understand our history here. We got to understand history. We know what's going on. The second line, that's what I'm saying. We know what's going on here. A lot of black people, New Orleans, when Balboa and DeSoto and all those people went over there. I think it was DeSoto. One of those guys went over there and his group was like, hey, these are black Native Americans over here. Especially out there in the South Carolina, North Carolina, you have the Yamasee. They were saying, hey, the Yamasee tribe, these are Negroes. The Yamasee tribe, those are tribes of Negroes who were there way before Columbus. And they've been trying to bury the lineage of the Yamasee people for years. The Yamasee tribe were a bunch of black people who'd been over there for thousands of years out there in South Carolina, North Carolina. I think out there in South Carolina, don't they have a little town called Yamasee? Yamasee, North South Carolina, where it's a predominantly black area. I think the majority of people who live there are black out there in Yamasee, South Carolina. So there's still a town out there. You dig? And somebody said Creek Indian in the chat. See, we got to understand a lot of those tribes, they were different tribes. And the white supremacists just call them one name. If you live by the creek, they'll just say, hey, those are just Creek Indians. Yeah? This is why we have to understand our history. And we don't even have to get into California. California, I mean, we look at what they said about the California Indians. This is in the early 1800s. They said a few years later in 1806, Langsdorff described the same Indians in California with more detail as follows. These Indians are middling or rather low stature and of dark brown color approaching to black. They have large projecting lips and broad, flat, Negro-like noses. Indeed, many of their features are as well as their physiology and almost their color bear strong resemblance to the Negroes. So they were saying how the natives in California are basically black folks. And this is a picture. When they start taking pictures in the late 1800s, we see the Negro phenotype in many of the Native Americans. So this is us just understanding history here. Now, this is where things took a turn. This is when the reclassification started getting real heavy. In the early 1900s, Number one, you start having the $5 Indians. You had white people paying $5 to be labeled as Native Americans so they can get access to the land and basically parasite their way into it and start taking over. They would put the Indians, the Mongoloid-looking Indians, on these reservations and then whiten them up. They would send them to these Victorian-type schools to teach them how to be more white. They started whitening them up. And what they started to do in the early 1900s, they started to reclassify en masse Native Americans as Negroes. Family, I want y'all to write this guy's name down right here. This is Walter Plecker. This white supremacist here, and he was a white supremacist, not a suspect. This was a hardcore white supremacist. This is an article that says how a long-dead white supremacist still threatens the future of Virginia's Indian tribes. This guy right here, Walter Plecker, he was a part of a lot of white supremacist groups in the early 1900s, and he was a eugenicist. He was a part of that whole eugenicist movement. Okay? Walter Plecker. That's this guy's name here. This guy was in charge of the Virginia Register of Vital Statistics. Okay? He was in charge of all the documents out there. And this kind of set the tone for other places around the country. There were other white supremacists like him, but he's the most well-known because he did the most damage. Walter Plecker. Walter Plecker basically got thousands of birth certificates and names of Native Americans because he didn't want black people to get access to any resources. He wanted to erase black people's history. He was the one who helped codify the one drop rule. See, a lot of people think the one drop rule was all about keeping black people away from white people sexually. That wasn't just it. It was really to keep black people from claiming their Native American status. So if you had any black in you, if you were a Native American, or if you looked like a Negro, he and his office would go to the records and just change all the birth certificates, all the marriage records, everything from Native American to Negro. They did this in the thousands. Walter Plecker, this man right here, changed a lot of people's racial status and really without them knowing it. So a lot of people, you went to bed as a Native American and you woke up a few months later, you were a Negro and you didn't know it. You went to bed a Native American, then you woke up a Negro. If you look like a Negro, he just reclassified you as a Negro. They did this in mass. This was the early 1900s. They did this for decades, by the way. He did this. And another one of his proteges, it was a woman out in Louisiana. This woman right here, Naomi Drake, she was doing the same thing. Look this woman's name up. Naomi Drake. She was working for the Louisiana Office of Vital Statistics. She was doing the same thing. Anybody in Louisiana who had a little afro, your lips were kind of big, your nose was kind of wide, you were Negro. You're not Native American, you're not Creole, none. If you look black or if you had anything that was suspicious about being a Negro in Louisiana, this woman would change the record. Naomi Drake, she died in 1987. She's a piece of crap. I think they tried to sue this woman. I mean, this woman messed up thousands of people's records. Look these names up, guys. I'm giving you receipts to look up how insidious these people were with changing our status, changing who we were, reclassifying us. These people were very insidious in doing this. Now, it gets deep. Now, going back to Plecker. Now, Plecker, he made it illegal for Negroes to marry white and those miscegenation marriage laws. He's responsible for most of that. Now, remember when they did that movie called Loving versus the State of Virginia? The state of Virginia is him. That was the case that they were going against. Mildred Loving was trying to get married to that white man. Well, she got married to that white man. And the law that they were fighting, the quote-unquote state of Virginia, it's his ass. It's the William Plecker law, the law that William Plecker put together, where if you got one drop of black blood, you can't get married. Now, here's the thing. Let me go here. This is Mildred Loving right here. That's Mildred Loving. Mildred Loving was a victim of Plecker's reclassification. Mildred Loving is a Native American. This woman right here, Mildred Loving, is a Native American. When she got arrested and all that, they listed her as a Native American, but this case is the case of a black man and a white woman. Mildred Loving is Native American. I want y'all to look that up, but they just reclassified her. Plecker and all of those people reclassified her as a Negro. The Racial Integrity Act. They don't tell you about that in all the documentaries and movies about her. They leave that part out, that she's really a Native American. She's not African American. She's a Native American. She just looks black like many Native Americans do. So we got to understand the game that's been played here, guys. These people have been erasing our history and lying to us so that we can't take a stake in our land, in our lineage. Many of you have grandmothers and grandparents in the South who said, hey, my great-grandmother was a full Indian, and they were not lying. We got to look at a lot of black people. Take a good look at a lot of black people. Lena Horne. Take a good look at people like Johnny Mathis. This man is Native American. Take a good look at a lot of black people. Take a good look at Rosa Parks. Rosa Parks' family, she is part Native American. Rosa Parks is part Native American. A lot of black people are part Native American. For real, they just reclassified. You understand? So we got to understand, when we talk about us being foundational black Americans and this is our land, we mean just that. This is our land. We got to stop letting these people make us think that we are foreigners. Pam Grier, she's another one. If you can look at Pam Grier and tell, Pam Grier is another one. But family, this is our land. When we say we are Native American or we're Aboriginal American, it's not niggas just trying to be exotic. A lot of people are telling the truth. A lot of folks, James Brown, he looks like he's Native American. If you look at James, he looked like a little Aborigine, don't he? James Brown had it in him. You can tell. You understand? This is our joint, and we don't have to be ashamed to say that. And it's not about denying Africa. We know that we are mixed in with the African bloodline, and that's a great thing, but we're not going to deny our lineage and our birthright, because this is our land. And see, when people come along and then try to tell us that we're a guest on our own land, see, when you know who you are and you know your lineage, you won't let people step to you sideways. When you know who you are, you won't let people step to you sideways. So somebody said James Brown look African. Nigga, what person in Africa looks like James goddamn Brown? Let's stop. No, we don't. Let's be clear. And I love my African brothers and sisters, but we can tell we look different for the most part. You can look at somebody and tell, okay, that person is from Africa. You can look at their facial features. Not one person in Africa look like no damn James Brown. James Brown is one of a kind. That's our Negro right there. Don't nobody over there look like James Brown. We own in that. That's us over here. Let's stop. That's our Negro right there. Don't nobody look like James Brown, but James. No, nobody on earth look like James Dan Brown except James Brown. That's a South Carolina Negro. Let's stop. You understand? James Brown has an original look. Just like we can look at certain people and say, hey, they ain't from here. They got their own look, like Tarana Burke. She's Caribbean. Don't nobody over here look like no damn Tarana Burke. Don't nobody look like no damn Tarana Burke. You dig? Maybe an Olmec statue in Mexico somewhere, but not nobody in North America. Shit. But nobody look like that. Let's keep it a buck here. Like Chaka Khan. I think, ain't she Native American? She got some Native American in her? A lot of us do. A lot of us do, and there's nothing wrong with that. This is our land. This is our lineage. We got to take claim to that. We got to take a hold of that, and we got to respect that. and understand as foundational Black Americans mixed in with the African brothers and sisters, we are a very distinct tribe of people. And we got to own that and pay homage to that. So anyway, guys, y'all can do some more research. Go, if you haven't seen Hidden Colors 1 and 2, we go real deep into this in Hidden Colors 2. The next movie that I do, when I talk about the rebellions and when I get into the Seminole stuff, my next film when I'm done with Buck Breaking, we going to get heavy into that, guys. We going to get heavy into that part of the game, okay? But anyway, that's been today's episode of Tariq Radio. I gave y'all a lot of information to research those names, and dig deeper because the rabbit hole is very deep, guys. Don't forget, go to officialfba.com. You can get and watch the Foundational Black American Conference at officialfba.com, ladies and gentlemen, officialfba.com. All right, guys, you guys be good. Y'all have a great holiday weekend with your family. Show light, show love.